Leah here from leahfirstsight.com, and in this video, we'll break down the concept of resonance as it'll show up in your organic chemistry course. You can find this entire video series along with my practice quiz and study guide by visiting my website leahfirstsight.com/resonance. In the Orgo Basics series linked below, we looked at how to draw the Lewis structure for molecules and ions. So let's take a look at the NO3- Lewis structure. Starting with the skeleton, we have nitrogen, single bound to 3 oxygen atoms. Looking at the checklist, we have atoms. Let's work on the octet, electrons, and formal charge quickly. Again, you can see the step-by-step in the Lewis structure video. What this comes to is a nitrogen double bound to 1 oxygen and single bound to the 2 other oxygens. Nitrogen has a formal charge of +1. The 2 single bound oxygens each have a negative formal charge, and that gives us a net of NO3-1. But what if I chose to put the pi bond on the lower right oxygen or the pi bond on the lower left oxygen? Would that be incorrect? And the answer is no. If I have the pi bond on the lower left oxygen, that oxygen is neutral, nitrogen still has a positive charge, and the 2 other oxygen atoms each have a negative charge. If I put the pi bond on the lower right oxygen, same thing. That oxygen is neutral, nitrogen still has a formal charge of +1, and the 2 other oxygen atoms each have 3 lone pairs and a formal charge of -1. So how is this possible? And on your exams, how do you know which structure to show if there are 3 possible structures that all appear to be correct? And the answer is resonance. So what exactly is resonance? According to the dictionary, resonance is the sound or vibration produced by one object caused by the sound or vibration produced by another object. Ouch! That to me is a very tedious and potentially confusing definition. I like to think of resonance as just something vibrating back and forth. What specifically is vibrating back and forth? The electrons that are moving from one atom to another on the same molecule. When we look back at these 3 molecules, it's not just about the fact that they're all correct, but more importantly, how to interconvert between one and the other to show that resonance, to show those electrons moving back and forth. To do that, we have to use curved arrows, which you may also hear as pushing arrows. The idea behind an arrow in resonance and in mechanisms is the movement of electrons. The arrow tail always goes where the electrons are on your molecule, meaning where they're starting out, and the arrowhead shows exactly where those electrons will wind up. It's not one electron that's moving, it's 2, and I like to think of it as one electron carried on each point of the arrow. This is to differentiate between a radical arrow. The radical arrow looks like a fish hook. It only has a half arrowhead because it's only one electron. With these arrows, you want to ask yourself which electrons are capable of moving and where can they move to. Let's start with the structure all the way on the left. To get from the left structure to the middle structure, it looks like we want the pi bond to move up, but that's not the case. In fact, if we do that, we're going to violate the octet on both oxygen atoms. If we take these electrons and move them up, that means oxygen, which already has a full octet, now has a total of 10 electrons, and the oxygen here loses that pi bond for a total of 6 electrons. Instead, you want to start your resonance at the most negative electrons, so we'll take these 2 electrons that have a negative charge on oxygen and bring them down towards the positive charge nitrogen, because opposites attract, and that's how we form the pi bond, which we'll now show here in blue. These are the 2 electrons. But nitrogen, which already has a full octet, would now have a total of 10 electrons, which is not allowed. So nitrogen has to let go of 2 electrons, and we'll show these 2 red electrons as a pi bond collapsing onto the oxygen atom. Notice that this arrow tail is on the lone pair, and the head winds up in between 2 atoms. It winds up in between because we're forming a bond, but here the arrow tail starts in between because we're showing a bond moving, ends up on an atom because the electrons are landing on that atom, and then we show a double-headed arrow to show the back and forth resonance, and here's what we have. The blue electrons formed a pi bond. The red electrons that moved will now show here as the two new electrons on that atom. We still have the two green lone pairs, and the third lone pair is the former pi bond that collapsed. Now, how do we go from the middle structure to this structure on the right? Once again, it looks like the pi bond has to collapse downward from the upper oxygen to the lower right oxygen, but in fact, that's not the case. If the oxygen on the right is going to lose its negative charge, that's where the electrons have to start moving. So we'll start the arrow at the two electrons that we're showing in pink and move it in between the nitrogen and oxygen because we're about to form a pi bond. One more time, nitrogen has more than 8 electrons. It has a more than full octet, so we have to kick out 2 electrons. We start the arrow at the blue bond to show that these electrons are moving. We end the arrow at the oxygen because that's where the electrons will collapse. And then we show a double-headed arrow. After the double-headed arrow, always show what changed, meaning what do we have as a result? As a result of the pink electrons moving, we now have a pi bond that will show in pink, where the two electrons are the former lone pair that used to be on oxygen. The blue electrons that collapse onto the oxygen atom will now show as the third lone pair sitting on oxygen, and we already have the formal charges in place, where oxygen, when it has 3 lone pairs, has a negative charge, and oxygen that only has 2 lone pairs and a pi bond is neutral. One more thing you have to show with resonance is a bracket around all the structures. And what this tells you is that everything in the brackets is constantly resonating back and forth, back and forth. So it's not a question of which structure exists in nature. Do we have this one for 25% of the time, this one for 35% of the time? No. In fact, none of these represent the real structure of the nitrate ion. They simply show you different extremes of what that intermediate looks like. Let's look back at the initial structure. If we had electrons on oxygen moving down, moving in this direction, moving in that direction, moving in that direction, the electrons are constantly moving back and forth, so quickly that it's impossible to show it on a two-dimensional paper. That's why we have to ask, where are these electrons moving from and where are they moving to? Well, they move in this direction. Okay, so we'll show one structure that has this negative. It moves in this direction. We'll show another structure that has that negative. It moves in that direction. We'll show another negative. But this is just a way for us to be able to represent it on paper. In reality, the electrons are moving so fast between all three structures that what we have is this resonance hybrid intermediate. An interesting way to think of this came from one of my students, and this is what he said. A dinosaur is an imaginary creature. Some people will argue that. I've never seen a dinosaur, so I have to imagine what it looks like. A unicorn is another imaginary creature. Again, I've never seen one, so I have to imagine what it looks like. But if a dinosaur and a unicorn were to mate, their offspring would be a hybrid, an in-between, which is a rhinoceros. Looks a little bit like a dinosaur, a little bit like a unicorn, but it didn't get its unicorn parents' looks, and it's something in the middle. It's not that it resonates back and forth where half the time it looks like a dinosaur and half the time it looks like a unicorn, but instead it has qualities of both parents and exists as something in the middle. If you want to try to explain its parentage, then you can describe a dinosaur as one extreme and describe the unicorn as the other extreme. And that's the idea behind showing resonance structures where the electrons are on one atom at one extreme and the other atom at the other extreme. But the resonance hybrid, that rhinoceros, is the actual structure, and that is how the molecule exists. Depending on the molecule, it can vary from 2 to nearly infinite numbers of resonance structures. Let's take a look at the enolate ion as an example. If we have an enolate comes from alkene. Ol is an alcohol, 8 is a deprotonated negative alcohol with 3 lone pairs on oxygen and a negative charge. These negative electrons can resonate towards the sp2 hybridized carbon to form a pi bond between carbon and oxygen. But carbon, which already has a complete octet, cannot accept that extra bond unless it kicks something out. So we'll show the electrons forming the pi bond getting kicked onto the carbon on the left. The reason we don't kick it onto carbon on the right is because it'll have too many electrons. But pushing it to carbon on the left, now both carbons still have a complete octet. Show the double-headed resonance arrows in between to show that it's going back and forth. And then start with your skeleton. Since your sigma bonds don't break in resonance structures, it's easiest to start with the skeleton and ask yourself what stayed the same and what changed. Oxygen had 3 lone pairs, but now it has 2 blue lone pairs that haven't moved. The red electrons form a pi bond between carbon and oxygen, so we'll show it right here. The purple electrons that used to be a pi bond are now sitting on the carbon at the end as a lone pair. And of course, don't forget to enclose your resonance structures in brackets. The next step is checking formal charge specifically to see that you have a conservation of charge. Remember, electrons can move, charges can go from one atom to another, but the net charge of the total molecule will always stay the same before and after your resonance. We started out with a negative charge on oxygen for a net of negative 1. Our second resonance structure doesn't appear to have a charge. This is where you have to know and understand your formal charges. If you're not comfortable with it, see my video link below. But here's the problem. Typically, we're looking for bonds and atoms to see a formal charge. But for carbon, all I see is line structure and a lone pair, so here's a trick. If carbon starts out with a pi bond and ends up with a lone electron pair, it has 1 more electron than it had previously, because directly attached to carbon, we only have 1 electron of the pi bond, but 2 electrons of the lone pair. That second electron makes it more negative than it was in the previous step, so if we start with carbon neutral, we wind up with carbon negative 1. Oxygen should have 6 valence. It has 6 touching it. 6 minus 6 is 0. That means the only charged atom is carbon, for a net of negative 1. Negative 1 equals negative 1, charge is conserved, and we are good to go. To show the resonance hybrid, or the rhino of this structure, we start with a skeleton, show any electrons that are not moving, and then simply show dotted lines where the electrons are moving back and forth. Since oxygen carries a negative charge for part of the time, we'll give it a partial negative. Carbon carries a negative charge for part of the time, we'll give that a partial negative, and that's our resonance hybrid. Now what happens when you're given a molecule that looks like this and you're asked to show all of the contributing resonance structures? Let's start with the lone electron pair and a negative charge. Let's show the lone pair in green and start here moving the electrons over towards that carbon-to-carbon pi bond. These electrons will form a double bond, but the pi bond will have to break away, otherwise carbon will have an overfull octet and that is not allowed. To show these electrons moving away, we start the arrow at the bond and end the arrow at the carbon because that's where the electrons will collapse. So we show a double-headed arrow, then start with a skeleton, copying everything that hasn't changed. That makes it so much easier. We have oxygen that hasn't changed and the pi bond on the left. Now let's see what has changed. The green lone pair of electrons turned into a pi bond between that carbon and the one up towards the right. The blue pi bond collapsed as a lone pair on the carbon atom. And remember the trick, if carbon started out with a pi bond and has a lone pair, it gets a negative charge. Quick conservation of charge, negative in the starting molecule, negative in the next structure, we are good to go. Now where can we move it from here? The blue electrons can move counterclockwise to form a pi bond, causing the electrons between carbon and oxygen to collapse onto the oxygen atom. We show the double-headed arrows, redraw the skeleton and anything that hasn't moved, and then see what did move. The blue electrons form a pi bond between carbon to carbon. The pink electrons form an extra lone pair on the oxygen atom. A quick formal charge on oxygen tells us that it has a charge of negative 1, and that's our resonance structure. But that's not the only thing we could have done. Looking at my initial structure, I could have also taken those green electrons and resonated them towards the left, causing these electrons to collapse. That'll give us another set of resonance structures with the left side of the molecule resonating rather than the right. So when you draw out the resonance hybrid, you'll notice that the entire cyclohexane has resonance, meaning the electrons moving back and forth, and we also have some resonance going up to the oxygen atom. So the resonance hybrid would have to show all of that with a partial negative charge on oxygen and then a partial negative charge in the ring, because the negative charge is resonating between all the carbons within that carbon ring. So if you have so many options, how do you know where to start? Do you start at the lone pairs? Do you start at the pi bonds? What happens when you have a carbocation? That's exactly what we'll discuss in the next video. Be sure to watch this entire resonance series. Download the cheat sheet so you have all the rules in front of you at a quick glance. And then once you're comfortable with the material, make sure you try the practice quiz and see how well you do. And you can find all of this on my website at leahfirstsci.com/resonance.
Are you struggling with organic chemistry? Are you looking for resources and information to guide you through the course and help you succeed? If so, then I have a deal for you, a free copy of my ebook, 10 Secrets to Acing Organic Chemistry. Use the link below or visit orgosecrets.com to grab your free copy. After downloading your free copy of my ebook, you'll begin receiving my exclusive email updates with cheat sheets, reaction guides, study tips, and so much more. You'll also be the first to know when I have a new video or live review coming up. If you enjoyed this video, please click the thumbs up and share it with your organic chemistry friends and classmates. I will be uploading many videos over the course of the semester, so if you haven't subscribed to my channel yet, do so right now to be sure that you don't miss out.